Afternoon, everybody. Thank you. I'm the one with jet lag. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here today. It's quite an interesting subject. The last time I addressed this subject of seamless shopping journey, however, was about 2 or 3 years ago. You know, from our perspective, we sort of see this as table stakes. It's just something you have to get right. And we're going to use the next hour to really talk about what are the barriers to really getting to a seamless experience in an excellent sort of way. What are the challenges and what is the prize? So we're going to talk about that. But I guess the starting point for me is, why are we even talking about it? And I think we heard this morning that, you know, we are witnessing the consumer shopping in a very different way. It's emerging here in India. You know, you go to the States or you go to the UK, and they really are shopping very, very differently to the way they would in the past. There are distinct phases. There is the phase around explore, research, going online, talking to peers and social channels. It's a critical stage because they say about 70% of the research online or in-store or through social network groups leads to a sale, 70%. So it's an area that's really fundamentally important for a retailer. From the research stage, you move to the buy stage, buy my way, anytime, anyhow, any device. That in itself presenting challenges for getting that homogeneity between those different devices and different times. The third stage is fulfillment. Now, fulfillment's changed beyond recognition as a result of online, where we move from bulk to eaches, and fulfillment now means my way, anyway, to my house, to my office. Again, very easy for a customer to demand that, really complex for a retailer to deliver on that. And if you get those four phases correct, or those three phases correct, you're then either rewarded or punished through the final stage, which is either through social media. So we are seeing a different shopping journey. That different shopping journey presents challenges. One of those challenges we're going to explore in a second is, how do you provide that customer who simply expects it a seamless, homogeneous shopping experience? So I'm absolutely delighted to be moderating this illustrious panel. We have a real blend today. Apart from having six in the panel, which I think is a record today, we have a blend of retailers. We have a Boston consulting group here. We have a technology provider. So we've got a real blend of different people. And I'm hoping, you know, we can really begin to understand what the challenges are in offering a seamless customer shopping journey. So before I start, I'm just going to ask them to quickly introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Nihir Parikh. I work with Nykaa.com. I'm the chief business officer there, and my primary goal is to make sure that we hit our revenue targets every month, working across all the departments there. Pleasure to be here.
Yeah, hi. I'm Vikrant. I head business for GreyOrange in India. You've just gone through the presentation of GreyOrange, but I think it's important to know that we are one of the largest robotics companies right now in Asia, and also a part of a very industrious group called the RBR 50, which is the best robotics companies in the world. So that's coming out of India for you.
Good afternoon. I'm Gaurav Mahajan. I'm from Raymond. Raymond, as most of you would know, is a 90-year-old vertically integrated textile apparel organization. I guess what's relevant from the point of view of the discussion today is, we are perhaps the largest lifestyle retailer in the country, with a chain of almost 1,200 stores spread across 420 towns. So that was perhaps the largest penetration that any lifestyle retailer has in the country. Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
I'm Abhishek. I work for Puma, which some of you might know is the largest sports brand in India. Not just the largest in sports, but in terms of a global brand, probably the largest single brand in the space of footwear, apparel, and accessories, global brand. A bit of claim to fame on this, that we've implemented omnichannel, as we were talking outside this forum, for about the last 1.5 years, dabbled with Puma.com, integrating stores, also integrating social platforms and discovery sites into our network, and have a very strong loyalty database as well from our online, our offline stores, which are about 350. So we've dabbled with a lot of things of integrating online, offline, social marketing platforms.
Hi, my name is Abheek Singhi. I work at BCG, the Boston Consulting Group. And I just had one question for the audience. We are not able to hear ourselves very clearly. Are you guys able to hear us? Okay, good.
It's half the size.
Hi, my name is Harsh. I am one of the founders of Fynd. Fynd is an online to offline fashion retailer and a technology partner. We work with about 200 brands across 8,000 stores, allowing consumers to order directly from stores and allowing other stores to also order from the other stores.
Great, thank you, panel. So I guess the starting point has to be, what does this mean? What is a seamless shopping experience? You know, if you ask 10 people, you'll get 10 answers, so let's try with 6 different answers, perhaps. Abhishek, can you maybe start with yourself?
Well, I think a consumer today is discovering products, making decisions about what they want to buy, then going to various channels of available for the brand that they have to offer, whether it is online, offline, exploring, trying out the product, then making a purchase decision and buying the product, and post buying the product, either going back and returning the product or having a post-purchase opinion or a feedback on the product. So, and also today, social platform-wise or on their social media, posting with friends on various networks that they have about their opinion about the products. It's a very wide array of activities. Mm-hmm. And I think the topic in point is how does a brand, and consumers today anyways do it, right? They go to discovery sites, they search a product, and then they go and buy somewhere, and they're doing it themselves. I think the point here is whether a brand and retailer can structure this consumer journey into something in which they can conveniently have the convenience of doing what they want and when they want it. So I think this seamless integration is the sinking of this consumer journey.
Yeah, okay. Now here you mentioned that you are a pure play company that has now started opening stores. How has that changed, this knowledge of your consumer, the way they navigate online to offline?
Right, so we've basically the largest beauty e-commerce site in the company. So when we were thinking of strategy, we obviously realized that omnichannel, the word that's used by everybody, is obviously a direction that we should also consider. So we studied our consumers very carefully in terms of the experiences on the site, in terms of the SKUs they buy, in terms of what they're adding to cart. And we actually now, we've set up 4 stores, we're expanding a lot more, and we've realized one very important thing, that we want to bring the online experience offline. And everybody says this, but what we're actually doing is bringing an on-trend store concept. And what that means is we've realized the consumers are looking for a certain subset of products. We have 650 brands on our site, 40,000 SKUs. But the core products is a subset of products we've studied, and we're bringing those online products to a physical store, which will contribute to 20-30% of our online sales will be available in one store, which will cater to 80% of consumers' needs. So that'll be a completely different way of bringing the online experience offline, having studied the online journey very well. What we're also doing is we've studied the physical store concept very well, and we realize as a beauty player, the beauty associate plays a very important role. You walk into the store, they know your T-zone, they know your skin tone, and they're obviously providing products and recommending products that make sense for you. So from the other element, what we're taking is trying to bring that offline experience to the online consumer by building a technology, building in routine finders, asking a few questions, and trying to see what it makes sense. So the consumer journey makes sense from both perspectives. And in terms of a seamless experience for us related to this, it's about we've worked really hard to set a consumer expectation. We, like maybe 4 years ago, we were nobody. Consumers had no expectations from us. So we were just doing the hygiene things. Today, there's an expectation we have worked hard in from a marketing standpoint to leave the consumer with 2 to 3 key USPs about our company, be it content, be it education, be it genuineness. Those are the 3 pegs that we've built our company on. So both our experiences need to bring content advice out. And that's really the experience that we've built out, and we are working towards delivering that promise to our consumers.
And Gaurav, you know, is your opinion consistent with those views, or do you see something else when we talk about seamless customer shopping journey?
I think we are all sort of, you know, our job is to follow the customer or preempt what the customer wants. And the fact is that customers are living an increasingly seamless life. They're more mobile. But I think what's disruptive is the fact that consumers and the entire environment is exponentially more digital today than it was. So everybody lives on the smartphone and seamlessly lives off it as well. So, you know, even while you're sitting here, like one of the other talk sessions that was going on, the guy was saying that, you know, if I'm, you know, sitting here and if I'm not interested in what's going on the stage, I'll get out of my phone and do something, whether it's work or entertainment or whatever. And I think so the fact is that consumers are living a seamless life, and this is a trend which is going, they're moving seamlessly between digital, physical, within physical, different kinds of channels and experiences, and they're moving across geographies. Yeah. So it is imperative for anybody who's trying to sell products to consumers to be able to traverse all these zones that the consumer is traversing along with the consumer seamlessly. And I think therefore there is no running away from the fact that you have to be able to either communicate with your consumer across these channels. And there are two, my sense is that there are two distinct parts. There is communication stroke access to your consumer. How do you reach your consumer and talk to him or her about what you're offering? And that's one piece, and you have to today. There is no other way but to be able to do it across whichever channel consumers are in. If they're on social media, if they're online, if they're in television, or you know, if it's physical, you have to be able to do it. And the second part is transacting. And I think that is perhaps tougher. So for us as an organization, I think, you know, we are an organization with a very rich legacy and a business which has developed very strongly over the years. As a part of the overall transformational journey, I think we are very committed and conscious that this transformation, the ability to traverse all these zones that the consumer is traversing, is absolutely critical. The important thing is that we don't overdo it. I think, so there is the first part in terms of being able to reach our consumers, and there is a lot of investment we have. So we have, frankly, you know, we've set up an independent cell inside the organization. It's called the Digital Customer Center. And we do that also because we believe and understand the fact that this is a new area. It's a new skill. In fact, even the most advanced people or the most proficient people in this area are still learning, some of them on this stage. And everybody is learning and we're all discovering. And it's a very different mindset. It's a different competency. And you have to house it inside the organization like an independent startup. So step number one is commit yourself and, you know, in your mind, accept the fact that this is the way of life. And you have to learn and find your way to create an independent sub-organization within the organization, which actually is given a free hand to experiment and learn. And it's not necessarily bound by business metrics, not necessarily at this stage. And we are, you know, there are two things that are happening, you know, immediately that we can see on the kind of near-term horizon is one, a seamless view of our consumers across channels. And you know, seamlessly catering to consumers, and this is something that everybody would have heard. It's almost like a very cliched thing now. Single view of customers, single view of inventory. And we have two distinct projects underway in the organization which are working towards us being able to see our customer wherever he, in our case mostly male, is, whether he's online or whether he's offline, whether he's in Delhi or in Bangalore or in Dubai. And the second thing, and be able to identify him and understand how he's moving across these various geographies, stroke, digital, physical zones. The second is our inventory itself. How our inventory is and the accessibility to this inventory. And being able to see it as, you know, a common pool wherever it is in the chain and be able to move it across seamlessly. So these are the two exercises that are underway. We are in the early parts of this journey. We're excited about it. But we are aware of the fact that, you know, it's going to be a, you know, steep and yet a long learning curve.
Some good insight, Gaurav, and I'm going to come back to that very shortly. Let me just get your reaction to some research we conducted last year. With PricewaterhouseCoopers, we did a survey with 350 CEOs, retail CEOs across the world, the most advanced markets, the emerging markets, and we asked them to rate themselves on how well they are executing against the subject. How are they performing and genuinely executing against providing a seamless shopping experience? Now, I don't know whether these facts are shocking or whether they're good, but it's quite interesting. Only 1/5 of those retail CEOs claimed that they were offering a seamless shopping journey. So every touch point from the customer was totally seamless. One view of the brand, one view of the customer, and that they had organized themselves internally, removed silos, so they had put in place robust infrastructure to make sure that there's only one view of the customer. Only one fifth of CEOs. At the other end, one fifth said they're doing an appalling job. They are providing a disconnected shopping journey, they still operate in silos, and I'm surprised they're still in business. But that is the fact. The interesting bit is that 60 bit in the middle, the 60%. What they were saying is they've dealt with the front end piece. They've actually stitched together all those touch points, call center, go to the store, order online, no stop start, it's all seamless, and it's one brand experience. 60% said they're achieving that, but they were still operating in silos. Let me get your reaction to those numbers. I'm gonna start with Boston Consulting Group. You have the privilege of working with a number of retailers across Asia. Surprised by the numbers or not?
So not surprised by the numbers, but I'm not sure whether the customers of those 350 organizations would have had the same view. Because in some sense, this is the perception of the company. You know, to my mind, the seamless experience is, and pardon my French, ranges from somewhere in between crappy and creepy, right? So there is the crappy experience where, every experience that you have at different points of the chain is siloed, bad view, etc.
Yeah.
And the other end of the spectrum is creepy, where you feel that you're being stalked or, right. Your computer or your phone actually seems to know, or the website seems to know before you do, which you find creepy.
Right?
To my mind, the seamless experience is somewhere between the two. And I would put out as a hypothesis that most companies actually are not able to offer that right balance, because unfortunately, even within the same category, what Abhishek may think of seamless may not be the same as me. So I think that's the challenge which is there in terms of delivering the same.
But if you look at it from the customer's expectation, isn't it easier to understand? If you're a shopper, we have a room full of shoppers here, does it need a PhD to figure it out? Or if you act like a customer who's shopping your brand, they want to have one experience, surely. Whatever the touch point may be, whatever the fulfillment may be, from a customer's perspective, is it rocket science?
So I think it is different. So forget online for a second. Even if I was to poll the people in this room and ask them, if you're going, let's say, to buy a dress or a shirt, how many of you actually like it when the person in the store comes and says, sir or ma'am, can I help you, and guides you towards specific dresses or items? How many people actually like that? How many people would rather be left alone? Right? So I think this is the piece in terms of being able to identify when and where. I would say, if I was to take this as an example, I think vast majority would like to be left alone, but get help when needed. Now, how do you deliver against that is the question.
Abhishek, you want to be left alone, or do you want to be intimate?
Well, see, our experience, however, is that this is what consumers feel. Mm-hmm. I, as a consumer, also feel that I want to be left alone, but truth is, irrespective of what kind of retail, we're always looking for help at the end, But if you ask, the first reaction always is that I don't need to be approached. Yeah. But I have seen through my experience in physical retail that the shop, and it will be for every retailer, a very different kind of an interaction, a very different kind of an involvement, but definitely not true that you want to be left alone,
Do you agree with that opinion?
So I think trying to be slightly taking an engineering approach to that would be that as a shopper, you essentially have two components of the shopping experience. There's an activity and there's information. And Abhishek is right in saying that we as consumers always think that we know what we want, and hence you go in saying that I don't need help. But there are bits and pieces of information that you need during your shopping experience that you need help with. Yeah. Well, that could be your smartphone, that could be a store associate, that could be your friend that you're calling up, anything. But there's definitely information that needs to be provided to the consumer. And the challenge for brands is that for the consumer, that information is coming through channels which the brand may or may not control completely.
Yeah.
And when you start stitching those together, that's where things get really complex, because either, I mean, you want to be controlling every channel that a consumer is on, but it's really difficult to do that. So you need to play an important role with those channels who are able to give either the activity or the information to the consumer while they are shopping your brand.
Yep. Now here, you know, very interesting point being made there. If we begin to understand our customers better, we know their likes, their dislikes. We can make personalized offers, we can approach them in stores. How do you deal with that fine line between intrusion and helpfulness?
In fact, I would add to that a bit.
Yeah.
You know, Indians, for Indians, shopping is a social activity. You know, the family goes. We have seen, even though we are probably a premium retailer, our every store staff knows their consumer, and they have, you know, irrespective of how much technology you provide through loyalty programs, they have their small diaries, they keep down their numbers, they get calls for weddings, parties of consumer, of people who shop, of shoppers. And I think there is a social interaction, there is knowing each other, and because it's a social activity, it goes beyond sometimes just the information that you seek, because it is beyond that. So I would say that, you know, and that's why I think physical retail is a bit different from offline retail. Offline consumers behave very differently sometime in their buying behavior. The online retailer and offline retailer sometimes behave very differently.
Yeah.
And one of the biggest challenges, as I think today, of seamlessly integrating in the topic that we are having is, because they behave differently in our mind, we think, and they do, we create these silos. So there is a marketing platform, there is a marketing department which interacts with consumers, communicates with them, creates a database, and that's a silo. Then there is offline, they have offline stores, there's probably a loyalty program, maybe not, and then there is a department. We all structure our organizations like that. And then there is an online play, where is the .com or even the third party multi-brand, and we all create silos. And when we create that, whenever we are trying to do this single customer view, it becomes a very, very complicated, because you're creating cultures and ways of working which is very different. And make no mistake, and having done this for some time, it is a very, very difficult do to integrate sometimes, because you create these silos. And I think the challenge is that we need to break that. And as leaders of different brands and retailers, we need to first endorse, like Gaurav said, we have to endorse first that there is a need to do this. Once we do that, I think the operations is itself challenging. But I think breaking the silos, breaking the very different cultures which get formed is the biggest challenge of synchronizing the experience.
Yeah, and I guess my own experience, visiting a number of emerging markets, working with a lot of different boards, the starting point is a silo. You know, the minute you switch on a website, the minute you have some fulfillment, you've got to have a tiger team who are really going to drive that, you know, penetration. So silos, though, you're saying are bad. At what stage do they become bad? Abhi?
No, I think that's a great point. I think most organizations actually start off saying, you know, this thing requires focus, therefore let's put a dedicated team, you know, give them autonomy, freedom, et cetera, et cetera. And it starts with the right intention. I think the challenge which ends up happening is at some point of time, it has to integrate with the rest of the business. And I think the trick is to design it in a manner that X number of months or X number of years after the thing has started, it actually integrates back very well. That's difficult. And building on what Abhishek and Gaurav has said, the couple of things that I've seen work very well is if you actually take somebody who's been an established performer leader in quote unquote the offline or some other field, and you make him or her the champion, that typically works well. The second thing which works well is actually finding a way to cross-pollinate people across the different silos that you've built and make sure that the not only the tangible incentives, but the success of the same is celebrated in a manner where it's not at the expense of the other.
Right.
Those are, you know, sort of slightly softer factors, but actually make a huge, huge difference.
I think, Lee, it's a basic law of humanity. If you want a change and you want a new system and you want it to sustain, it must be self-sustaining. So essentially what you need to do is you need to create a formula or a system which demonstrates benefit. So if there are silos, the only way you can break them is when people realize, and people are smart, you know, on an average. When people realize that actually breaking these silos is actually for my benefit, you know, or for a larger benefit, you will find that the silos will disappear. The initial part is always tough. So it's always a little bit of carrot and stick. You have to, you know, excessively incentivize, and you have to put your foot down, you know, whoever is driving it as from the head of the organization. If you know it's got to be done, it's got to be done. But, you know, eventually you have to find that formula where it works and it actually is a more beneficial system to be. And that, and I want to comment on the intrusion thing that you're talking about. And I think it's a very critical point, because I think that in this entire digital revolution, the aspect of privacy and the criminal impact, the potential criminal impact of the lack of privacy is something that none of us have really understood yet. And I think it's a ticking time bomb. I think in this evolution of society at large, you know, going physical and going excessively digital, social, digitally social especially, I think there will be some earthquakes. There will be some melting points where we will have to pause and think, what the hell are we doing? What the hell are we creating? And it's almost a social subject. It's not a technical or a technological subject. It's a social subject. The ills of digitization, and one of them is the what can the lack of privacy do to a society at large, is something that we'll have to grapple with. But to answer your specific question on, you know, how will you get people to break that barrier, it's again the same law of humanity. Look at digital payments or, you know, online payments. There was, especially in India, you know, this huge mental barrier. And there's a whole generation which would not do it, you know, even if their life depended on it. But when your life depends on it, or when you find that this is actually perhaps the only way or a better way to do things, you gradually start turning, and you know there is a curve, and you know you eventually find that people are moving, but because they see the benefit. So intrusion and privacy, you know, just to come back to that, I think is a massive subject. It's an unexplored subject. It's a subject that we haven't really entirely understood, and it will descend upon us in a big way. Maybe not necessarily a positive way is my doomsday prediction. You know, not very positive, but I think it'll come. We'll overcome it and tide over it, but it'll be one of those points in the digital journey of humanity that we will have to encounter.
I was just saying, to add to the silos and how the departments work, we're actually going through that transition in our company right now, and we're actually struggling with that question, because we went from being a really small startup where one person was involved in all decision making, setting up one philosophy in the company, to now a sizable mid-sized company where now you have 9 leaders involved in structuring the company, and that's the transition we've done in the last 1 year. So we're seeing decision making getting a little more fragmented because no one person can take all decisions in the company at our scale. So one idea we've started now implementing is making sure you have lean crack teams for every challenge, which is cross-functional by definition. So any project or any strategic area, by definition, needs to have at least 3 departments involved, one person from each department, and no team can be more than 4 to 5 people in size. So this lean cross-functional really helps us make sure that all departments have important champions involved. One person owns it at the end of the day for accountability. And moving forward, we're trying to do a lot more to make sure you have a well-rounded view.
So in our company, we recently sort of made that shift. And there are no departments anymore in the true sense of the word departments. Because as you start a project, you start filling functional roles first. And beyond a point, those functional roles have their end of life. So the way we've now figured out the organization, and I mean, we know that we're probably slightly less complicated than some of the brands here, is what part of the customer shopping experience are you influencing that becomes a team? So to give you an example, listing for on Fynd, whether it is brand partners or the catalog team, which ensures that consumers see good products, good information, is all part of one. So and a few of the brands that we work with, we see that it helps a lot when you have your buyers and your catalogers of the e-commerce team probably in one team, where then it is the same customer experience, whether it's in store or online, controlling what are consumers looking at in products. So I think figuring out what team can influence what part of the shopping experience of the consumer could be one way of rethinking the organization structure.
Okay, good. Vikrant, I'm going to come to you in a second and ask you about customer experience. Just before I do, I want to just bottom off this thing around silos. Quite interesting. I went to three very significantly large retailers across Europe, and I asked them individually, who owns the customer? And one said, oh, that's our merchandise director. The other one said, marketing. And the other one said, I think I do, a CEO. That's Europe. Pretty advanced market in retail. So it just makes me wonder, do you have to tackle this, and when do you tackle this, with organizational change? When we see the appointment of chief customer officers who are intended to represent the view of the customer corporately, irrespective of silos, is that taking a sledgehammer to crack a nut, or is that something which you believe can really make a permanent difference as we begin to offer this seamless shopping journey? Gaurav, I'm going to come to you first, and then to you.
I think, so I've been part of workshops where somebody's asked this interesting question, who owns the customer? Honestly, there are many different answers, and it's a matter of perspective. And without trying to answer the question, when we came up with this idea that we were going to go after this seamless digital experience or multi-channel experience, we created a team. And the nomenclature of the team gives you a sense, because we call it the digital customer center. We don't call it omni-channel team or online or digital. So we call it the digital customer center. And I think the first job of that team is to recognize the fact that the customer is living digitally. We understand how the customer lives non-digitally. And there is a certain amount of work that you can do to, access your customer, understand the customer, engage and build a relationship with the customer in that forum. What we don't understand, what is new to us, is the digital existence of the customer. And I think that's why the digital customer center has been done. It is not a technology initiative. It is entirely an initiative focused around understanding the digital lives and the digital ongoings of the customer. And ownership, as to who owns that, I think the debate can continue. I really believe that there has to be a body in an organization which has the ability to track and service the consumer, provide service to the consumer. The rest of the organization is actually servicing the consumer through this body, which owns what the customer is doing, what the customer is getting, what the customer is not getting. And they are kind of removed from the rest of the organization. They're independent. They almost belong to the customer. And they're outside the organization, almost like a body which is keeping, almost like the customer watchdog over the rest of the organization.
Okay. And Abhishek, Puma, do they have a chief customer officer? Should they have a chief customer officer?
I don't know whether it's a very different view, but I think consumers today have four primary ways in which they're interacting with a brand. The first is the discovery. Second is the any kind of content from the brand. Then is the commerce. And then is the the community that customers build, whether it's a social community, whether it is, you know, so there's a content, commerce, and community. And before that, there is discovery, before they decide on the brand. So I think all of them have different touch points. Whoever is interacting with these various touch points, wherever the consumer is touching the brand, I think that's a customer touch point. And I think it has to be jointly owned, because if someone's going to a store and we say, okay, the retail store, or in some cases the franchisee, is the owner of that customer, that's not true, because he's coming and buying the brand there, consumed content from that brand somewhere else, building, following the brand on social platforms somewhere else. So I think all of these are customer touch points, in my opinion. And sometimes it is offline, sometimes it is online. So I think all departments managing front-ending these four platforms, or the four different elements of the customer touch points, are owning the customer in some ways or the other. But I agree with some of the discussions that there has to be one larger view on this, that who sees that there is a seamless commonality or a seamless integration of these customer touch points.
Yeah, and again, you heard my opening comments. I absolutely agree with you. I think there was a new shopping journey, discovery, buy, fulfill. Everyone's got a different flavor of it. I just wonder which one's the most challenging. You can have a great strategy around providing a seamless shopping experience, but where does it fall down? And just my experience in the more advanced markets, it's falling down in fulfillment. The area Amazon chose to focus on the most. How do we do fulfillment in the shortest possible time? So click and collect in 5 minutes, home delivery, same day, hour slots, whatever. Fulfillment seems to be a new challenge. Vikrant, you know, you're involved in this space to some extent. What are you seeing and hearing out there?
So I'm going to take this up more from an execution standpoint, because we are a pure play B2B enterprise organization. On the point of the definition of roles, I just wanted to make a point. You know, we're a startup, so we can experiment with a lot of stuff. So when we kind of fill these roles, we expect the guys to write their own job expectation notes. And there is always, you know, apart from the attributes of the roles and all that, there's always your impact on the end customer. So everybody in the organization who writes his gen knows what his end customer impact. It's easier for us because we are a B2B organization. I'm sure it's going to be much tougher for that to percolate into larger organizations. But okay, so a couple of factors. You know, I mean, great to hear that. You know, omnichannel is a great word. It's a great word for me as well. Another word that we keep hearing is GST, and the other one is that, of course, there's a whole proliferation of SKUs now. So from an execution, pure play execution standpoint, I think what we need to kind of take these macro factors and also see the micro ones, which are like the operational efficiencies and a higher throughput. And we get to a point where we know that there are some bottlenecks that need to be kind of curated for you to deliver that seamless experience. Because what we are suddenly seeing is that right now we're not talking about, and I'm talking about more tactical here, that are we talking about each is reaching somebody who's shopping online in time, the right product at the right time? Or are we talking about boxes and crates and, you know, maybe pallets reaching your distributor at the right product at the right time? So what you probably want is something that kind of disrupts the entire supply chain as well. Because I'm sure there's going to be a lot of marketing activities around, a lot of branding activities around it. But when rubber hits the road on any kind of an omni-channel experience, it's going to be the execution that will play the vital role. And the granularity in terms of the product is kind of going down every day. We know that, you know, maybe an e-commerce does a 1.4 SKU per customer, or a large apparel manufacturer would do, you know, 150 SKUs per retailer. But the granularity is going down every day as we look at omnichannel. So our ability to handle it at the SKU level is something that, you know, we need a lot of automation in. So I'm just bringing it down to the fact that, you know, we've kind of created this organization around the fact that we understand that there's going to be a challenge around this. Every year, you know, our customers are talking more in terms of value engineering the entire supply chain to us. Every year, they're talking about having larger warehouses. to address the GST, larger SKU proliferation, and of course, you know, the fact that they're going to be servicing multi-channels through the same warehouse. But how do you do it? Because with the same kind of manpower, it's just not possible. So that's my take on it.
And just returning to that subject again around the customer shopping journey, you know, that is what has changed. That's what's going to change in India in due course. Where's the big challenge in your point of view? If you look at your business, where would you focus, where would you give this audience counsel on that shopping journey to really start investing in?
I didn't get you.
As we think about the new customer shopping journey of the very important step of discovery, which influences, you know, 70% of sales, we think about the purchase, anytime, anywhere, anyhow. We think about fulfillment, same way, anytime, anyhow. Where do you think you should double down the investment in that journey?
Oh, it's a very long list. but I think first things first, there's a lot of low-hanging fruit. There's a lot of basics to get in place. As I was saying, my ability, you know, and you were talking about implementation in your last comment, your ability to have a single view of your inventory and your ability to move it seamlessly across channels. And that might sound like, duh, you know, that's very basic, but it's not. And most of us are wired in a way that we can't do it. Especially large organizations. It's easier maybe for the online guys, but I'm sure the online guys have their fair share of issues that they face. And something as basic as that needs to be encountered and sort of taped up before you even talk about anything else that's more evolved. And you can actually, you can go to the moon on this. You know, you can do all kinds of things. People talk about, and you said there are people who are saying that they're doing a great job of building a seamless customer experience. And trust me, I've heard a lot of stories of possibilities or claims as well that people, you know, a customer walks into the store, the guy at the back, you know, the manager gets a message who's walked in and, you know, his whole profile, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a lot of things you can do, but I think there's a lot of basic building blocks. Your ability to actually get your product to reach the consumer bases the consumer's need. And then there are a few other things, or you build on top of that. As I said, it's a single view of customer. Your ability to understand who your customer is and how that customer is moving across your various channels is really the second step. Yeah. And everything else is very evolved.
And something that resonated this morning from one of the speakers, I think it was Govind from Shopper Stop, he said three things. It's about single view of the customer, single view of inventory, single view of the order. Very simple, but that requires a fair bit of investment. So I'm going to come to you from a Boston Consulting Group's point of view. My question this morning, I'm going to ask it again. When do you invest? Do you invest before the demand materializes so you have the infrastructure in place? And how do you deal with the consequential effects of that ROI? Or do you invest when it actually is about you?
So to the question that, or you know, to the three points that Govind had made, I think the ROI on the single view of inventory and the single view of the order, actually the ROI or the payback is fairly, quick. Yeah. So, if one is a retailer, I think from a perspective of a short-term ROI, the second and the third, which is inventory and order, I think is a no-brainer. Yeah. I think the question on the customer or the consumer is a trickier one. My personal view is it's better to be the number two guy to invest from an ROI perspective rather than the first one. Right, because you actually have somebody else to learn from the mistake. The obvious challenge is if everybody waits for somebody else to make the investment first, then then you run into a trap, right?
Yeah.
Right. So that's the tricky part. And unfortunately, on the customer side, I can't honestly look anyone in the eye and say do it in piecemeal and so on, because I think some of that investment is actually a chunky one. The only generalization, the glib generalization I would make is actually look at from your category perspective. I think there are some categories where, investing in the customer actually just makes more sense. And I would typically, we don't have anybody from financial services, but I would say financial services, investing in the customer is a relatively no-brainer because the paybacks from a lifetime perspective start coming out. Yeah. So the one thing I would look at is where you actually see a significant switching behavior across brands or channels, there probably you want to be later,
yeah,
where you actually see greater loyalty or propensity for loyalty, then probably better to be early in the curve.
Okay, good.
So to add to that, I think from my perspective, it's really about what is it you want to delight the consumer in and what is it, what memory do you want to leave the customer with and invest in that area. Because every business needs to do the same 20 things, right? From getting a customer, acquiring, we spoke about this a few times. So the point is, what is your USP where you are going to differentiate? Is it really fast delivery? Then you have to double down on that, and that's a direction you want to differentiate from competitors and really differentiate yourself. Are you saying you're a content player who will then enable you in terms of education to then let you buy? Then that is the area you will double down on from an investment, USP standpoint, marketing, and finally execution. So, and you can't invest in 20 things. Nobody can do that because you can't leave the customer with 20 delight points. Doesn't happen. They leave the room or any experience only with two or three key messages. So you need to figure out what are your two to three key messages and invest in that. For Nykaa, for example, we've decided content and education leading to consumer buying is the area we're going to double down on, and we're going crazy with it. So it's really about asking yourself that question.
I think the customer's remembrance of your brand is fairly biased towards their last touch point with your brand. Right, so whether for an online retailer, whether it is the delivery experience or the offline retailer, it is the point of sale experience. In short, the moment of truth for the consumer, for your brand, is the transaction point. And hence, you know, seconding what sort of Abhik said, is that point is completely in your control and not really outsourced with other channels where the customer is discovering and browsing you and, yeah, and coming to you by. So I think the easier answer to that, and I think the correct answer as well, is fix the things that you are in complete control of, which is going to directly affect the customer's moment of truth with your brand.
Yeah.
Just one quick add to what you mentioned. I completely agree with you. The only add I would do is, whether it's education, whether it's content, whatever, I think also just identifying which are the 10, 15, 20% of my customers where I actually get the maximum ROI,
yeah,
on the same is a great ad if you can do it. If you can do it, whether you use it through your loyalty program or, online, whatever information that you have,
yeah,
if you actually can do that, that's fantastic.
I'm going to stick with this theme of money, ROI and money, and just want to explore the size of the prize. So I think we've, in the last 45 minutes, talked about why you have to have this homogenous shopping journey, how you might enable it. We've had some very good insight. But what is the prize? You know, if I'm going to invest in this, I know I will protect my brand if I have a consistent brand experience. But where's the money? We hear anecdotally in the UK that people like Tesco, John Lewis Group, Marks & Spencer, they say it's not just about brand protection, but it's also about converting customers from digital to physical. In China, they've set out their whole plan around O2O, online to offline, as a deliberate strategy. And in our survey results, we found that they were actually achieving the highest increase in customer spend. In the UK, those three retailers talk about a single channel customer being converted to a multi-channel customer, spend about 2 to 3 times more. That, to me, sounds like a big prize. Is that the incentive, or am I missing something?
Absolutely. I think it's not just the number of times you can sell more. And I'm sure, we all will have different experiences. The customers bumping out of your system and going to somewhere else,
yeah,
is huge today, whether it is offline or online. Because as more and more development happens in retail, there are more and more opportunities, the more and more brands, shopping centers, offline, online, online players. So the only way you can protect the customer from going out of you is to give him the convenience of consuming your content and your product and transact with you.
Yeah.
So I think there is a huge prize, like you mentioned. There's a huge reward to this. And not doing this is not an option, because I know that there are a lot of brands. I know, for example, there are very successful multi-brand retailers, and I don't want to name them, who were extremely successful 5 years back, are no longer successful because of the advent of online. And they resisted they thought that that was competition. They are pure play retailers. Yeah. And they thought that's a different animal. They're hitting them with price. But the truth is, there should have been a transition made towards them in which they approach their business. And people didn't see it. People were in denial mode. Yeah. The good thing today is, I think most of us are not in denial mode. Some of us are endorsing it a bit more, but everyone endorsing it. People know that it's a requirement. So that way, I think there is a huge reward. Not doing it is not an option.
Yeah, and I hear you. I hear the implied concern about a pure play person not being able to do that. Of course, it's a single channel. So I say this tongue-in-cheek now here, tongue-in-cheek. Is that why you chose to move from an e-commerce pure play into stores, or are there other reasons?
So our vision is to own beauty in this country. It doesn't matter what you're doing. We know long-term, 90%, 85% of the sales will be offline. And if our vision is to own beauty in this country, we cannot ignore that segment. So there's two strategies in place. One is, going back to the point, 70% of the influence is going to happen through mobile or online. We own that piece already. Yeah. A lot of the purchases are still happening offline. We need to own that piece as well. Then we are first on top of mind, be it a first-time consumer buying in an offline store, be it a novice or be it an expert. Whatever your beauty routine is, you got to have Nykaa in your purchase influence cycle. And that's why even the content play becomes important, because people, there's a huge education element. Like today, people are buying shampoos and not conditioners. I mean, it sounds very basic, but not enough people are buying conditioners. So there's a huge education element as well, which we will be working and taking the ownership of. So the offline channel is to our strategy, an extension of what we are trying to do. Yeah. And we're going to own that and do that not only from a basic copy-paste perspective, but innovate and add value over and above what other players are doing, which is just putting products or complete brands there. We're going to come up with new formats which will add value. Then only are you actually making a difference.
Yeah, good. It's coming up to the 10-minute mark, and I want to open it up for questions. But just to conclude on this, so
just one point I wanted to make on
please.
This, because on our offline flavor, we understand that, you know, the consumer walks away if he doesn't get the product at the right time at the right place, right? And he does make that purchase elsewhere. So it's a loss of sale. But online, I think it's even more dangerous, because if the experience of buying online, and we're all kind of, you know, moving towards it and embracing that change, it just stays with him permanently, you know, that experience. It doesn't get, so you can still walk into a store later for another pair of shoes or another pair of, you know, whatever he's buying for, if he didn't get it this time. But online, if that experience kind of, you know, dilutes itself, it's a larger impact it has. And I think, you know, the large retailers, the e-commerce players, are already recognizing that in some shape or form. It's just for the larger community to embrace that change in a larger way and say, how can supply chain also influence it in a way that, you know, that experience is seamless.
Gaurav, final word, size of the prize. The size of the prize.
I think I completely agree with Abhishek. The size of the prize is staying in business. I think it's not an option. It's not about what additional business you can do, and I think there's a lot that you can do. I think you can build a lot of efficiency. I mean, endless aisle, which most people would know, your ability to actually expand your offer to your consumer without having to physically commit to space would be a fantastic shot, one of the pieces. But I think the picture is much larger, because you don't have that option. He's talking about some MBOs. I'm saying anybody who in this business in about 7 to 8 years' time, maximum 10, and I might be proved wrong, it might be 3 or 5 years, does not build the ability to actually have a seamless play, will find themselves either completely out or losing ground very steadily. So the prize is staying in business. You know, it's as imperative as that.
Okay, great. Thanks.